The Board of County Commissioners acts as a quasi-judicial body when it hears requests for rezonings and conditional use permits. Applicants must provide competent, substantial evidence establishing facts or expert witness opinion testimony showing that the request meets the zoning code and comprehensive plan criteria. Opponents must also testify as to facts or provide expert testimony. Whether they like or dislike a request is not competent evidence. The board must then decide whether the evidence demonstrates consistency and compatibility with the comprehensive plan and the existing rules in the zoning ordinance, property adjacent to the property to be rezoned, and the actual development of the surrounding area. The board cannot consider speculation, non-expert opinion testimony, or poll the audience by asking those in favor or opposed to stand up or raise their hands. If a commissioner has had communications regarding a rezoning or conditional use permit request before the board, the commissioner must disclose the subject of the communication and the identity of the person, group, or entity with whom the communication took place before the board takes action on the request. Likewise, if a commissioner has made a site visit, inspection, or investigation, the commissioner must disclose that fact before the board takes action on the request. Each applicant is allowed a total of 15 minutes to present their request, unless the time is extended by majority vote of the board. The applicant may reserve any portion of the 15 minutes for rebuttal. Other speakers are allowed 5 minutes to speak. Speakers may not pass their time to someone else in order to give that person more time to speak.
Good evening. Welcome to our March 2nd meeting. It's Thursday evening, and we all welcome you, and we thank you for being here. This meeting will be called to order, and we'll have our invocation this evening with a good friend of mine, Father Dimitri Sigas, and he's going to tell us a little bit about his church and lead us in an invocation.
Thank you, Commissioner. Being the Greek Orthodox Church, we're about show and tell, so I brought some show and tell for y'all. So this past weekend was our 45th annual Greek festival at St. Catherine's. We have about 200 families that serve 10,000 people, and almost 1,000 of them came through our church as well, and I gave a church tour there. So I give you a copy of the prayer I'm about to pray, a copy of my business card, our Sunday bulletin, and the insert that I gave to our church tours this weekend. I was sharing with Kurt that we have four generations, really, but three generations just at their mini bar. We have a World War II veteran who served in the Pacific. His son was an attorney locally, and his grandson have taken turns serving in our minibar, you know, over the 45 years. And even have some families have been here for four generations, St. Catherine's. We have parishioners in each of your districts. Our parish runs the length of Brevard County, 75 miles long and 30 miles wide, equally spread out, by the way, across the county. So we are very blessed to have that. I am the previous immediate past president of the South Brevard Ministerial Association, and the month of March we declared Love Brevard Month, and there's an enclosure there for you as well. There's a list of churches that are seeking this month to reach out to schools, community centers, individuals, charities, and do whatever work needs to happen at each of those places to make them a better place. So a lot of landscaping at our schools and community centers. So with that, I'd like to join you in prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, as we begin this meeting of our Brevard County Commission, we come before you asking for your blessing, guidance, and protection over your servants, our Brevard County Commissioners, Chair Kurt Smith, Vice Chair Rita Pritchett, Jim Barfield, John Tobia, and Christine Esnardi, all their staff and families. We pray for our County Attorney, Scott Knox, and Deputy Attorneys Eden Bentley and Shannon Wilson, for County Manager Stockton Witten, Assistant Manager Vanetta Valdengo and Frank Abate, their staff and families. Pamela Barrett, Sandy Daughtry, Joy Roth, and all their families. We pray for our Sheriff Wayne Ivey and for all our men and women in uniform as they protect and serve us. We ask that you may protect and bless them and their families. We pray for a property appraiser, supervisor of elections, tax collector, clerk of courts, public defender, state attorney, court administrator, their staffs, and all their families. Lord, we pray for all those who serve the citizens of Brevard County and our county government. Grant them all the wisdom of Solomon, the devotion of David, the good and effective stewardship of both Josephs, Joseph the great steward under Pharaoh in Egypt, and Joseph, the earthly stepfather of Jesus. They wisely put the citizens of Brevard County at the top of their organizational chart. Lord, our nation's founding fathers understood and sought to have no other king but King Jesus. They understood that you are at the top of the organizational chart, then our citizens, and then the various branches of government. Lord, as our county commissioners meet this day, we ask that you may guide them to make decisions that will care for our environment, care for safe and effective transportation for all who live and visit here, care for the respect of private property rights, care to limit government and increase freedom. Guide them to make decisions that will be a blessing to all the citizens of Brevard County and not to just a select few. Lord, I came here kicking and screaming 10 years ago. I now thank you for bringing me to this relative paradise where business and freedom can thrive and bless the citizens of and visitors to Brevard County. Thank you, Lord, for our churches and all our houses of worship. During this Love Brevard Month, help us make a loving and lasting impact in our communities. Thank you, Lord, for your divine providence, for your love and compassion for us all. We praise, worship, and glorify your holy name, of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Bless you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Would you follow me in the pledge, please? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, looks like we only have one item on our consent agenda. Eden, would you like to touch on that, please?
At the last zoning meeting, you had a small-scale comprehensive plan amendment and a rezoning request related to that comprehensive plan amendment relating to the Cameron property in Fort St. John. You have two findings of fact in front of you, one denying the comprehensive plan amendment and one denying the rezoning. We'd like to request one motion on each item, one motion to deny the comp plan and one to deny the rezoning.
So can we have a motion denying the comp plan?
I make a motion to deny the comp plan.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Commissioner Pritchett to deny. We have a second by Commissioner Barfield. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Passes 5-0. Now we need a motion denying the rezoning. Can I have a motion to do that, please?
So moved.
Commissioner Barfield moves to deny the rezoning. Do we have a second?
Second.
Commissioner Zanardi moves to second that. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Passes 5-0. Okay, now we'll move into public comments. I have none. Okay, so we'll move to 4B1.
Good evening. This item, 4B1, is a request by SRK Vera Village Associates. This is for the Beef O'Brady's restaurant located at Morrell and Vera Boulevard. They're requesting a conditional use permit for alcoholic beverages to include full liquor. They presently have beer and wine for the on-premise consumption.
Pleasure of the board.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion by Commissioner Iznardi, second by Commissioner Barfield. We have any discussion? We have no cards. All those in favor say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Passes 5-0.
4B2, this is Cocoa Commercial Center Condominium Association. They're requesting a small-scale comprehensive plan amendment to change the future land use designation from a community commercial to planned industrial park and change of classification from BU1 and BU2 to PIP. This is on 7 acres on the west side of US 1, just south of Pam Lem. The LPA recommended approval. It was unanimous, and so did the Planning and Zoning Board.
I have cards. Ron Housk.
Yes, sir. My name's Ron Housk. With me is Paul Chinaris and Ray Brown. We serve on the board of directors for the Condo Association of Cocoa Commercial Center. we can have a presentation, but we agree with staff's comments and the planning board's comments. So we'll save time for you guys if you guys have questions.
Okay, so basically, you're here for questions.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Does any of the board have questions? Hearing none. Pleasure of the board.
I move to approve.
Commissioner Pritchett makes a motion to approve.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Rosnardi. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Passes 5-0. Okay, we have 4C.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm Erin Stark with the Planning and Development Department. Tonight you're hearing three items, all under C, 2017-1.1, 1.2, and 1.3. I'd like you to make separate motions on all three items. We're here to review the transmittal of these to the nine state agencies for their review, and then you will hear this item again, these items again, in a few months for adoption. The first item, 2017-1.1, is an application by Florida Power and Light on 461.7 acres. It's south of Mico Road and adjacent to Fleming Grant Road. It's a proposal to change the future land use designation from residential 1 to public facilities. They are a utility provider regulated by the Public Service Commission, so this is the appropriate land use for this proposal. They are seeking a companion rezoning application to GML, and you'll hear that at the adoption. A preliminary review of the availability of public facilities and services indicates that there's be very little transportation impact. There's no need for public water and sewer, and I think we have an applicant representative here that can speak more to that. And then in your package, we have received 5 written public comments regarding this proposal. Mel?
Thank you, Commissioners. Mel Scott, 7175 Murrell Road. It's my privilege to be representing this comprehensive plan amendment package to you at this transmittal hearing. Thank you, Aaron, for the introduction. You've covered a lot of the points very well. I'd like to thank county staff for their assistance to this process. They've been great. It is my pleasure to present this opportunity for us to convert a use which used to take sunshine and create fruit for us to enjoy, and now we'll be taking that same sunshine and converting that to sustainable, clean energy. That's our intention. That's what you see in the application. We're going to have short presentations by 2 representatives of Florida Power and Light, Bart Getchens, who's our external affairs representative for Brevard County, and Aaron Wachowiak, who's the project manager. We will certainly be here for any questions should they arise as a result of our presentation. Should any of the public comments spark questions that you need some answers to, we're here for that. While we certainly would love for you to approve this project at this time, again, a point of clarification, we're simply asking that you find this application good enough, reasonable enough to at this time be sent to the Department of Community Affairs, or the Department of Economic Opportunity, I'm sorry, so that they can then receive comment from state agencies. That's what this action that we're requesting tonight would exclusively do, allow the state to receive this, compile comments and observations, bring them back to you. Then it's our intention to be back here for a final public hearing in late April with the public hearing package, as well as the conditional use permit, which will again provide much greater detail as to what we'll be doing with this property to achieve this goal of converting sunshine to clean, renewable energy. And without further ado, Bart Getchens, thank you.
Thank you, Mel, and good evening, Mr. Chairman and County Commissioners. My name is Bart Getchens, Area External Affairs Manager, Florida Power and Light, 9001 Ellis Road, Melbourne. And this evening, I wanted to give you a little bit of background about FPL and our parent company, Next Era Energy. And I'm not sure if there's a clicker here. Oh. Okay. A little bit about Next Era Energy. We are the world's number one producer of renewable energy from wind and sun in the world, operating in 30 states and Canada, but Florida is Florida Power and Light's home, and we consistently rank among the Fortune World's most admired companies. A little bit about FPL. We serve 35 counties within Florida. There are 55 electric utilities, just to give you a perspective. We power about half the state, 4.8 million customer accounts, and we equate that to around 10 million people. We are the third largest utility in the United States. Something we're very proud of is our record of affordable, reliable, and clean energy. Our carbon footprint is 35% cleaner than the United States national average. Our reliability is at 99.98%, and our bills are expected to be to remain lower or at the 2006 rate through the year 2020. We have a great deal of experience in both the design, construction, and operation of solar fields. And as you can see on the screen, our first venture into solar was in 2009 over in DeSoto County. That was the largest scale solar plant, the largest of its kind that was ever built at that time. Here in Brevard County, as you may be aware if you travel up North Courtney Parkway, before you get to the Space Center, we have a 10 megawatt solar field there. In Martin County, in 2010, we created the world's first hybrid solar natural gas energy plant, where we use solar during the day, feeding directly into our plant. And just this last year, in 2016, we had a partnership with the Babcock Ranch, and we created a solar center over there where they're actually developing a community around that solar center. We also added more zero-emission solar plant in Manatee County, and we're also venturing into, we did a project over in Citrus County. And now I'd like to introduce Aaron Wachowiak, our project manager, to tell you a little bit more about what we're doing in Barefoot Bay. Aaron?
Thank you, Bart, and thank you, commissioners, for your time this evening. We really appreciate you taking our application into consideration. We just want to tell you a little bit about our project so you know what we're asking you to transmit to the state. The project, it's about 462 acres. I think Aaron mentioned it's 461.7, but approximately 462. It is in southern Brevard County. We're looking to put 74.5 megawatts of solar. What that equates to is that it powers about 15,000 homes. So it's a pretty substantial increase in investment for us and for the state of Florida in adding more solar to our system. The one of the reasons that we chose this site in particular was because of how great of a site it is. It has no wetlands impacts, there are no species issues, and it's also adjacent to our transmission lines as well as a substation. So what that means for your purposes is that we're not going out there getting right-of-ways or building a bunch of new transmission. We're just going to connect to our existing transmission system. So it makes the projects more cost-effective from our perspective, but it also makes it a better neighbor, so to speak, because you're not adding all of this vertical construction. And the slide that you see before you now, it's just kind of the components that we use to build solar. FPL, unlike some other utilities, we work with the land. And so what we do is we drill the piles directly into the ground. They go about 10 feet into the ground, and then we put the systems on top of those piles. The solar panels sit on top of the systems. They get connected in the back, and they sit there and produce energy. So the vegetation continues to grow underneath the panels, and we just feed the energy directly into the grid, essentially. And this is just giving you an idea. What we are attempting to do with our layout is to be respectful of our neighbors and be a good community partner. So we've shifted our layout as far south as we could from our neighbors. And just to give you a kind of a perspective of where it is on MECO and Fleming Grant there. And then just a couple of key benefits for solar. We've kind of touched on them already, but essentially what it does is it helps offset our carbon footprint, right? So you're going to produce power for 15,000 homes, and what that means is, you know, people are going to have power. We're not having to add other sources. We're doing it through clean, emissions-free technology. We're removing cars off the road. We're going to create, you know, about 200 to 250 construction jobs for the construction period, which is about 6 to 10 months. And so that's supporting Brevard County in another way as well. And I guess the only other thing I would add is the way that solar works, we have these solar panels low to the ground. They're fixed mounted, so they will be about 2 feet tall or 2 feet high on the bottom and about 6.5 feet tall. So they're not a visual impediment, so to speak, because they're not very tall. You don't see them very much beyond the property boundaries. And that's all we have. If you have any questions, we would be happy to answer them.
Any questions from the board? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You have a question?
Yeah, I just needed to declare that. I've got a briefing from these individuals, Bart Ketchens and the rest of them too. So.
Oh, I did too. They came to my office and
me as well. I met with them as well.
Well, I can do one better than all of you. I went out to the site. And I saw panels at the, which site did I go to with the panels?
Space.
Up by the port.
Space.
Yeah. So, and I also can disclose that I have panels on the roof of my house. So, any other disclosures I need to make here? Okay. So, pleasure of the board. We need a motion to...
Cards? Anyone in the audience?
No.
I make a motion to make the transmittal.
Okay, we have a motion to approve by Commissioner Pritchett.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Barfield. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Passes 5-0. Okay, so now we're going to move to 2017-12.
I can need to give you the rezoning. Thank you, Commission. This proposal is by Granite Property Development on 48.258 acres, proposing to change the future land use designation from planned industrial and community commercial to residential 4. This property is adjacent to US 1, and it's a half a mile south of the intersection of Canaveral Groves Boulevard. The maximum allowable units on this property with a Res 4 future land use designation is 193 single-family residences. And eventually, if it's transmitted and approved by the state and you hear it and approve for adoption, you'll see a companion rezoning application to propose RU-17 zoning with a binding development plan. After a preliminary review of the public facilities and services, there's sufficient availability of all utilities and infrastructure in the area, and the applicant has agreed, and they will condition in their binding development plan to connect with the Cocal Utilities Sewer Service and provide public water and sewer at the property. The School Board of Brevard County's capacity determination report is also included in your package, and there's sufficient capacity with the adjacent concurrency service areas. And to date, we have received one public comment from an adjacent property owner, and you may have received a last-minute item withdrawing that objection today. So you should have a record of both in your package. And I believe the applicants are here as well.
Doug Engel.
My name is Doug Engel. My address is 497 South River Oaks Drive, Indy Atlantic, Florida. I'm here representing the owner, Granite Property Development. And I'm here to answer any questions you may have.
Okay, very good. Board have any questions for this gentleman?
I will have one. Do you have other cards first?
Well, we have one other card.
I was just going to request is if we put these through, I know that there was conversation about a binding development plan.
Yes.
And that if you would come back with that stating that you would be putting in the septic tanks.
No, we
I'm
don't.
Sorry. Connect to the sewer.
Oh, yes.
Step notes.
Yeah, no, yes.
I'm glad you made that face.
Yes.
bad septic tanks. No, if you would make sure you're connected to the sewer. And then there was one other request I saw in the notes that you were agreement to, that there would be a 250-foot setback from Precision's property on the north end of the property?
Yes.
That would be wonderful.
Right.
That was my only concern, and I heard you already agreed to it, so.
Right. I talked to them, as well as the other property owners around it, so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Engel. John T., you're up.
New business?
Well, you have 6F2 on here.
The resolution and CRAs.
Oh, okay. I'll save you. Okay, so we have no other cards. So on 217-1.2, do we have a motion?
We do have a motion, sir.
You're making a motion to approve?
I am.
Okay. Commissioner Pritchett makes a motion to approve.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Barfield. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Passes 5-0. Okay. Moving on to 217-1.3.
Thank you, Commission. This is a proposal similar to the last one you heard, seeking the residential floor for future land use designation on 130 acres. There's a conglomerate of current future land use designations, including industrial, neighborhood commercial, community commercial, and residential 8. This proposal would allow for a maximum of 521 single-family residences. They're seeking the same future zoning designation of RU17 with a binding development plan, and they have committed, and it's included in your staff report, to connect to water and sewer as well with the Cocal Utility Service. The school board had the same determination on the school capacity availability, and we have received 2 written public comments that are included in your package, and they will be transmitted to the state.
Thank you. A card from Christopher Weatherden. Okay. How about Bruce Moya?
Good evening, Commissioners. Bruce Moya with MBV Engineering representing the applicant. It's good to see everybody. How you doing, short timer over there? Basically, we got this piece of property the under contract, and we want to develop a new single-family residential subdivision. It's located on the north side of Camp Road, the east side or west side of US 1. It's got some borrow pits on it. It's 120 some acres, and the staff kind of introduced it. We're willing to come with a binding development plan to limit it to 4 units per acre, and that we will guarantee that we will hook up to the city water and sewer. It's kind of similar to the last one. So I'm going to keep it short. If there are any questions, if there's any of the speakers, I just would like to come back and rebut if they have anything to say. Thank you.
Thank you. Christopher, you're up. Your name and address, please.
My name is Christopher Weatherden. I live at 100 Seagrass Lane, Cocoa, Florida, which is directly across the street from the proposed development. And I just want to say good evening to everybody, staff, members of the board, audience. And I am in full support of this project. I know there is quite a bit of opposition to it from what I've heard recently, but honestly, I think it's going to be really good for the area. Right now, the property, as I see it, is filled with a bunch of defunct, out of business, whatever you want to call it, industrial sites, borrow pits, and so forth. And it also has a lot of homeless camps back in there that, I don't know, for us in the area, is not really a good thing. I think that the proposed development will be a plus-plus situation in all phases of it. And I would think that some of the unresolved issues that have been brought up recently might be able to be mitigated between Brevard County, the state, and the developers in order to make this development a viable and something that would be very good for the area. So like I say, I'm in full support of the development, and I think it'll do nothing but bring revenue and goodness to an area which basically right now has a connotation of being next to the jail, whatever else you want to say. I think it's going to be something, a shot in the arm that we all need in the area. So in full support. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you. And that's all the cards I have on that. So for Comp Plan 2017-1.3, do we have a motion to approve or disapprove or what are
we? We have a motion to approve.
We have a motion to approve by Commissioner Pritchett.
Second.
Second by Commissioner Znardi. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Passes 5-0. Okay, moving right along. Going to move into new business. F1. Mr. Tobiah, would you like to have the floor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And actually, I wish I didn't have to have the floor on this one. And I want to apologize to my fellow commissioners about the expediency of putting this on the agenda. It certainly was not my intent in any way. A couple resolutions had come forward out of my office dealing with CRAs. And I thought an agreement was struck at our last meeting on the 21st. I thought that you were pretty clear in your comments, and to remind everyone of the comments on the 21st, you said, and I quote, "I strongly advise them, being CRAs, to not try to go forward and extend their CRAs by creating any kind of debt. I trust them. They trust me. I'm not paranoid. I don't think everyone's out to stick me or be dishonest. I trust the CRAs not to encumber themselves with more debt and saddle people of this county with their being extended. I don't think we have any fear of this backfiring." February 21st. February 23rd, 2 days later. The City of Melbourne releases their agenda for the February 28th meeting. The agenda makes no mention of the obligation of county funds about the, quote, Highline project. On February 28th of this week, Melbourne City Council, on behalf of the CRA, of course, they switched over to vote on that, voted for a Highline project. It's $2.4 million bond, of which slightly more than 36% of that will be a debt service that us, the county, will be bearing. What that works out to over 20 years, just rough math, is $1.248 million, almost $1.25 million. So this is one of the things that Sunshine, you know, precludes. I had to bring this up here. I could not call your office and say, you know, what's your thought on that? But I go back to a quote, you know, that someone, my dad, told me ages ago, and he said, we can't ignore reality, but we cannot ignore the consequences of ignoring reality. And reality is that the CRAs, despite your clear warning, went out there 2 days later and put county taxpayers on the hook for almost $1.25 million. We have a workshop scheduled, but the workshop is not until April 13th. And assuming we come out with some constructive, and we were very constructive in our last workshop, so I have no doubt that we will have meaningful discourse. But the best case scenario is we make recommendations, and then our next meeting is 4/25. So basically, we are giving open season, for, as I mentioned before, to the CRAs to go create new ones, to go extend for more years, to add debt, which is most troubling to me. And I think we need to, unfortunately, discuss this, because despite your warning, they went out and did it, and 2 days later. And I think that we put them on notice, and they are pushing forward. So what I would like to ask you is if you think, despite this warning, it's still wise to, you know, I don't want to say stick our heads in the sand, but that's pretty much what we're doing, tell the workshop, or you want to press forward. I'm pretty cognizant that I have not spoken with any of the other county commissioners, but your vote is extremely important on this. So if you still want to wait on this, I won't be making a motion, but I just think it's incumbent upon us, because this will happen. I'm 100% sure this will, if it happens 2 days later, it's going to continue to happen, and county taxpayers are continually going to be saddled before we can get our hands on this. So this would be the first step to start doing this. I think on our next regular commission meeting, I believe a fellow commissioner's got another great resolution that would help put a stop to this. Tell the workshop, and I wish that we could place a moratorium to what you said. But clearly, they did not respect your warning. I was extremely disappointed, and I wish I wasn't having to do this. But you know, I respect your opinion and would like your thoughts, given you know what you said and the actions taken by one particular CRA, but nonetheless a CRA that will cost taxpayers to build an apartment complex in downtown Melbourne, $1.2 million, almost $5 million. What's your thought, Mr. Chairman?
How much time do we have? Well, let's start by, I'm not real happy that they went ahead and did this. I can understand why they've done it. This has been in the making for 3 years. But with that said, I don't know what the hurry was. They could have waited the 3 weeks or 4 weeks until we had our workshop. So I agree with you there. I'm not real pleased with their actions. They can be unhappy with me, but I guess the feeling's mutual. But I question whether this resolution, and I'm going to ask our county attorney, would this resolution do anything to slow them down or to stop them from doing going forward with their plan?
I don't know exactly where they are in their process. I mean, if they're already encumbered, you may have a problem. Stockton may know more. I don't know if he does.
Well, I think between myself and John, remember this CRA, and I know Scott is more of the expert on it, was created prior to the charter, us being a charter county. So I'm not sure that the board, regardless of what they do, has a whole lot of authority to do anything on this. This is a moratorium of creating new ones, so their issue is debt. But again, they were created prior to us becoming a charter county, and so didn't come to the county for the creation of that. And I don't think it's obligated to come to the county for anything pertaining to that CRA. But you know, again, John is more of an expert on me than me, and so he could probably help.
You bring up a very valid point. Had we gone forward with these, would that have precluded them from moving forward? I'd like to tell you yes, but no. It would have sent a message, and I want to be very clear that Commissioner Iznardi found the loophole. My thought was we are going to preclude these CRAs from extending, because when they extend, that gives them more opportunity to encumber debt. I did not foresee the loophole being that, well, if they have 21 years, well, I'm going to find 20-year debt in that. And that's what this downtown Melbourne CRA, and I you know, so when I read the resolution that Commissioner Iznardi came up with, I thought it was absolutely brilliant, and that would have been the one that would have precluded them from doing that. There's nothing we can do at this point about that $1.2 million that the county taxpayers are on the hook for. Not a darn thing we can do. I just want to make sure, and I don't know the actions of the board that will come out of the workshop on 4/13, but I want to make sure that what happened, because I sat through 3 hours of that meeting watching what happened.
The Melbourne
I went to the meeting. Melbourne City Council to watch what happened. I was shocked. I was outraged. But they were well within their right to do that because we had not taken any action. And I fear. I love your trust. I love your trust, and I wish everyone played by the rules. And let me be very clear. There's 14 or 15 CRAs out there. This is just one. This is just one, but it now has put the county on the hook for 1.25. I wish that I would have had the ability to call up the county attorney's office and got a resolution very quick that would have said exactly what you mentioned and put it in a quick resolution. No more expanding, no more expansion, no new CRAs, and no entering into debt until we have a work product after. I wish I would have had the foresight to do it. I knew bad things would happen. I wish I would have had the foresight to do that. But, you know, this is something that we could direct staff to put together. I wish your strong words would have stopped them. But I would be very comfortable at this point. We have a meeting next week. I think we could vote on at least to curb this from happening until we get a work product out of the workshop. Is that something that, you know, you would be comfortable with?
Well, let me just say that their charter, their CRA was formed back in 1982 before we became a charter county. So unfortunately, this is one of those instances that falls through all the cracks. We really. And it's one of the reasons that I have a problem with CRAs, not because of their intention of creating goodness out of blight. They have great intentions. I think that they have done, and most of them have done, wonderful work. But the other problem that I have is that they don't go away. And when we have a CRA like this one that was formed in 1982, I haven't spent enough time with our attorneys, but even our attorneys are kind of like, well, I don't know. We don't know what we can do to stop these things. It's a very difficult situation. So that's why we want to have the workshop, so we can try and everybody come together at one time and get a handle on this and get some cooperation going between the existing CRAs and the county government, and let's see if we can come up with some answers. I don't have a problem with this. I think it's a great idea. I don't think it's going to fix anything that we're talking about tonight, but it would prevent future CRAs from being initiated without.
I don't know that I'll get support from the board on any of my resolutions come the workshop. And if I don't have three people, I will not bring it. I have no intent to bring it back. But I think we should have that meaningful discourse. But I think there should be a moratorium so this doesn't happen. And you know,
well,
what if
this doesn't call for a moratorium, though?
And again, I did not have, you know, this just happened on the 28th. I was at the city council meeting till almost 11 o'clock at night doing that.
Well, if we had agreed on a moratorium, if we had a crystal ball and we knew they were going to do this, we could have done a moratorium, and it still wouldn't have had any effect on what they did.
But what the one created in you're right, 1980, this one created in 1982, mm-hmm. that has a 60-year lifespan because last year they extended to 2042. But there are many that have been created since, you know, many that have been created in the 90s, that, you know, some as soon as 2011 and 2012. Mm-hmm. Tell you what, if I'm one of those CRA people sitting on that CRA or an attorney working with the CRA that I'm watching this zoning meeting, you better believe I'm rallying the troops as quick as possible to thinking that, you know, I don't know the outcome of the workshop, but you better believe I'm going to do everything I can to take advantage of the current status quo of allowing us to get into debt, because there is a small possibility, I imagine, that the rules are changed come out of that workshop.
Well, your point is well taken. However, I don't see a room full of CRA people out here, so I don't think that they're planning any mass creation of debt.
I don't disagree with
again,
you.
Again, I understand what you're saying. We don't have any assurance that they won't. But I think it's a good indication that we don't have a room full of people, one. And two, I don't know how much debt that they could incur or force upon us in the next 3 weeks. I don't know that they...
That's not true. 2 days, because 2 days they put it on. So in 7 days, they put $1.25 million. So 3 weeks, if I'm just going on average...
Well, I agree.
They can
I
put
understand
another
what you're saying, but again...
$3.75 million on us.
This is a CRA we really have no control over. You could have had the foresight, you could have had a crystal ball, you could have known they were going to do it, and you still couldn't have stopped it. That's my point. I understand your point is well taken, that yes, we could have CRAs rushing out to encumber themselves and prevent us from shutting them down. I don't even know what the mechanism is for us to shut these down, and that's why I want to have the workshop, so we can discuss this and give our attorneys plenty of opportunity to come back to us and say, these are your options.
I hope you're right. And you know what? If the CRAs aren't rushing out to do this, then if the board staff came back to us on our next meeting and came up with a resolution with a moratorium on encumbering debt or creating new ones, mm-hmm. or you know, if they had no intent of creating new ones, and then they should have no problem with a moratorium. It would be an insurance, a free insurance policy.
But this isn't a moratorium. Your resolution here, let's talk about this one. And then we'll talk about the next one that may be a moratorium, but let's just talk about this one.
But again, I think a moratorium would be far more effective over the next 3 weeks to take care of the problem that we currently have.
Well, let's move forward with a moratorium when we get to it. Right now we're talking about this revoking the authority of Brevard County municipalities to create new community redevelopment agencies. Let's let the rest of the board weigh in on this, if anyone has anything to say. I have Commissioner Pritchett.
Yeah, I was going to say this one here, I think we denied this a while ago. There's a couple little changes in it. So here's my concern is the CRAs are not here to, and I understand what you're saying, Mr. Tapao, with the information you brought. But we have one of the ones up where I come from in my district that's one of the older ones, and it's one of the ones you can't do anything about. We can't have the county pay us more tax increments than the area will provide for what's provided. Now, we worked on paying off some bond debt so we could use the cash flows more into projects instead of paying off bonds. So if they've been, I'd have to ask Melbourne, they're not here, but if they've done this, they already have cash flows that come in from the county. So it's not that the county is going to pay extra cash flows. They're going to bond out money to do a new project to pay it off over time, which I'm thinking this one doesn't have a time ending anyways, unless they renegotiate the CRA. So there's a whole lot of questions we got to answer, even with the information we got on Melbourne. So I don't understand what they did. I didn't get to watch the program or have opportunity to talk to Melbourne and find out what was going on. But I do agree, Commissioner Smith, that this is a different breed from the other CRAs because it's in one of those early fours that have different rules and regulations, and they don't go away right now unless they renegotiate the terms of their CRA or agree to go into interlocal agreement. So on that, on this one that we're looking at here right now, and I know you're talking about the moratorium for the next one, I don't think that would have touched this either because they're under different rules. And I don't think that might have touched this anyways because they're not redesigning their CRA, they're just occurring. What I'm thinking when I was heard, a bond debt instead of just waiting for the tax payments to come in. So I would have to hear from Melbourne to find out about it. But if that's the case, I don't think a moratorium would stop them from being able to do that anyways, because they're currently getting payments from the county for that many years, if that many years are left on them, which there is. So that's my point on that.
Mr. Witten.
Actually, I just needed to clarify. When I was saying John, I was not referring to Commissioner Tobia there. I was referring to John Tkanich, the Cocoa City Manager.
Commissioner Znardi.
I would like to hear from the county attorney's office on if you know with 100% certainty if, because I think the question was, and I think where some of the confusion lies in maybe, and I'm not going to speak for anybody up here, is that the moratorium is possibly the solution to something other than this. And that's actually, if you've looked at your next advanced agenda for the next Board of County Commissioners meeting, that's actually something that I prepared with Attorney Scott Knox, was to put a moratorium on that. It wasn't to stop anything, but it was a temporary hold because of what occurred in Melbourne. And they did rush it through. Let's not be blind to that. Because I think that there's other things we can put into play as a county that may have made that a lot more difficult. Because in essence, I mean, I love downtown Melbourne. I'm sure most of the people in this room have enjoyed downtown Melbourne. They funded a private project for what a CRA is not intended to do. I mean, and that's what I take issue with too. That's why everybody's so paranoid about us doing anything with them. So, I mean, again, I wish, you know, it's a day late and a dollar short, but I wish that that resolution that I had worked on with Scott Knox had come sooner. Because at the very least, all it does is say, okay, let's pause, because we put this workshop out 6 years from now, which is something we should not have done. Then you know, let's say, because a lot may come out of that workshop. We may have put a lot on the county attorney's plate. It may take us a month to get back something from that workshop. And then let's say that there's some other snafus and we need to do a little bit more research. Then we're not here in June, and then now we're delayed, delayed, delayed. So if this is such an important issue, then I think it's something we probably should have either done a lot sooner, or at the very least, stop the bleeding now, and then if we want to make changes, we make changes. If we don't, then carte blanche. They can do whatever they want, you know. And I'm not anti-CRA. I know they serve a good purpose. I know there's some great CRAs out there, but there's also some ones that have done the wrong things. There's some ones that I think that need to go away, and there's problems in tax dollars. I'm the one that has to tell somebody, no, we can't finish North Babcock right now. And when I think about that $1.248 million in revenue over the length of those tax dollars, I mean, that would have fixed Babcock, I mean, in essence. But we've already, without even having any authority, have said, okay, we're going to take money from our coffers and give them to you for your coffers, but you're going to come and beat me down to fix Babcock. So for me, I have a hard time swallowing that. So if we can gain any sort of sense of control over that, we need to gain that control back. Or at least, you know, require that interlocal agreement. So we're doing the right things, and we are taking care of those areas that we should be taking care of. Because if the area needs it, like North Babcock, then it's justifiable. It's not an apartment complex in downtown Melbourne. I'm sorry. I mean, I love Melbourne. I love the people that serve there. I have no problem. But come on, if it was such a wonderful, fantastic, you know, life-altering project, it would have stood on its own, it would have had financial backers, it would have had people begging to get in on that project. You know, that's just my personal opinion. But I mean, I can't believe that that resolution was transmitted to Sally, and then I look at the Melbourne agenda and something like that's on there. It's just kind of crazy to me. But again, back to my original question for the county attorney. I mean, are we with 100% certainty that there's nothing we can do to stop anything that downtown Melbourne does with their CRA?
Well, so far as I know, as Mr. Witten said,
they predate the charter,
right?
Which means we can't do much to them at all. As to the other entities, I mean, you have a whole host of different types of and dates, and that could all be very significant.
Mm-hmm.
So each one may change. Maybe it's slightly different.
Mr. Barfield.
Well, first, I don't feel comfortable. We're talking about Melbourne, and there's nobody from Melbourne here to explain to us what's going on and how this worked and the whole background. I think it's just not right that we sit here and try to, you know, say all these things about Melbourne, and there's nobody here. Second thing is this, that, you know, anytime we need to push these things out because we've already said we are. Ethically, I don't think it is right to be making decisions on CRAs and the CRAs and the cities are not here. We have to remember that the cities are part of our county, and we need to treat them as part of this county, not as an adversary. And so I want to make sure that for now on, what we do is we make sure we have the people here and advertise at times so they can actually be here. I just don't think that's right for us to be able to say these different things about the CRAs of these cities, yet we have nobody here except John to talk to. So that's all I got to say.
Mr. Tobiah.
Just one quick point. I don't know if any of you guys' office, but I didn't get a call from the Melbourne CRA when they decided to bond and took $1.2 $5 million from us. So here's what I probably could have handled this in a different way. I probably should have handled this in a different way. What I've liked to have done was stolen Commissioner Iznardi's work product and brought it here. But what I would request from fellow board members is to take Commissioner Iznardi's resolution very seriously, it is the crux of what will, now whether we talk about these ones prior to the charter or the post, most are post. So hers will deal with the bulk of them, it's my understanding. And that what I would like to do is have a candid, frank, and open talk at the next commission meeting about Commissioner Iznardi's resolution, because that will provide that breathing room until we come up with a resolution or not after our workshop. So with that being said, because Commissioner Iznardi's resolution will handle the temporary problem far more than mine will, I would like to pull both of my resolutions from this agenda with the understanding that we are going to have some good discourse about stemming the potential bleeding that may happen over the next 3 weeks. And again, I honestly wish I'd not had to bring this up, but sitting there in that meeting for 3 hours, I was very disappointed, especially after the words that you, the words that you'd given.
Well, and I share your thoughts again, and I wish that we had some mechanism that we could slow these down, and particularly this one that was just, because I agree with you, Commissioner Iznardi, we're supplying county dollars to fund a private project. I'm not sure I've seen anything in any CRA that says that that's the purpose of a CRA. So to me, that makes that questionable. So I would like to have had the opportunity to have spoken with the people in charge and from the city of Melbourne. But again, I understand that we really have no control over what they do. So they can go ahead and do whatever they want, and they did. And so we're left here in the lurch. But that's, so now you're sharing my frustration over the last 2 years with CRAs.
Yeah, the bulk of them, though, are after the charter. It just so happens the one that took action was prior. So we definitely can deal with some. And I don't want to judge all the CRAs by the action of one. I think
that was the next point I wanted to make. That, again, we don't have a room full of folks here at CRAs, because they heard what I said, and they trusted that they would have an opportunity to discuss with us and come up with ideas and ways that we could go forward at our workshop. So I want to commend them particularly, and hope that with your proposal that's going to come up on Tuesday, correct?
And I just, you know, it's obviously not on here, so all it does is hold it. It doesn't tell anybody they can't do anything. It doesn't say, I mean, other than create more debt, but it doesn't eliminate their ability to borrow after the effect. It's sort of a temporary hold. It's just a moratorium to say, you know what, we're just going to pause here, because since that is the biggest piece of this, is that debt, and that's what makes us pay into it forever as a county, that was the one thing that I thought I could pull out that was very simple, that I would think that we could all agree on. And I would be hard-pressed to say, you know, if a CRA were to come here and argue against that, I mean, are they planning on borrowing more money until our workshop? I would question whether or not, if we're just doing the hold, it doesn't tie anybody's hands except from borrowing money until we do come up with solutions, because face it, like I said, it could be a couple of months from today before we have anything back on our agenda for us to vote on, especially if we decide to give a boatload of notice to everybody to make sure everybody can come out.
Well, I don't think we can say that a moratorium would be objectionable to any of the CRAs. Again, I want to commend them. They're not here. They trusted that we were going to give them their opportunity at the workshop. I'm not opposed to the moratorium. I think it does what we want it to do. If in fact there's some CRAs out there that we can influence them with our decision, I'm not sure we can. I don't know how much teeth that moratorium is going to give us. It certainly sends.
Oh, it'll give us a lot of teeth, actually, if we do a moratorium.
Well, I'm guessing that there's some other CRAs that we have no control over. That's my problem.
There's a few. Yeah.
Right. So, but we asked them to trust us. We told them we would trust them. I don't know that voting on a moratorium is supporting that trust, but at the same time, I don't think it does anything to harm the trust either. So. I'll be interested to see what you have to say there. Is that you?
That's me.
Okay. Commissioner Pritchett, you have the floor.
Yeah. Here's, even with Melbourne, you know, they do predate the charter. They know that this can't touch them. I can't imagine them saying, let's hurry up and get this done. It's probably been in their plans for a while.
3 years.
It's probably been a discussion. I mean, you just can't, have you ever worked at the city level? You can't get things done that fast anyways. So this is something they probably had in conversations for a while. It probably has. There's nothing we could have done with it. It wouldn't have changed it. And, you know, there's laws, too, that govern CRAs. That's why I'd love for Melbourne to be here and explain what it is they're doing, because you can't, with a CRA, just go out and say, hey, I'm going to build something. There's constraints of what you're allowed to do with community redevelopment funds. And there's very legal, you know, ramifications of what you have to work within. So I can't imagine them saying, hey, we're just going to go build apartment buildings. There's got to be something else to it. And I'm sorry, I just don't know. And if they did that, then, you know, something's going to come down on them pretty good, because you just can't do that with CRA funds. So this is hard on me not having them here, being able to have a discussion. And I really apologize for being ignorant to this, not knowing this had even happened, that I could study something out. I certainly would have, and maybe been able to have a little bit more of an intelligent conversation of why they did what they did. But, you know, maybe the conversation coming up Tuesday, I don't know, but I am really struggling with, since we removed this other resolution, every single meeting we have, we bring up CRAs. And I have my area asking me, do we need to hurry up and come down there? And I'm like, no, I don't think so. We're going to wait till the workshop. Otherwise, we're going to have everybody scrambling to get down here in a hurry. And I do believe we have a trust with the areas. We've been on the phone with a lot of them. We've been studying hard CRAs, how they work, how they don't work with other areas besides the ones that I'm used to. So I don't know. I'm looking forward to hearing from this gentleman and his opinion, because I think he's probably got a little bit more time putting into these types of entities, unless we have some information that maybe you, Mr. Whitten, can give us that would help with this. I would appreciate it.
It's a great segue, John.
And I don't know that there's anything that I can offer. I don't know that the city of Melbourne is actually going to finance it. I do know that getting debt is a matter of capacity, and so to assume that they have the capacity to get debt is a somewhat of a leap there. And they may, you know, as I read the article, it said they'll pay them upon CO. And so this may be a cash proposal for them that they already have in reserves. But I haven't talked to them. And so I'll let John go, but I'll talk to you about, you know, the process and my, I'll clarify my email from last night.
It's all yours.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. Thank you for the opportunity to appear again before you on CRAs and the proposed resolution. With all due respect, the reason why people aren't here is because the agenda was amended at 10:15 this morning. That's why CRA members and counties or cities are not here. And again, with all due respect, I mean, it seems fundamentally unfair to amend the agenda at that late stage, and even to put it on a zoning meeting. I mean, I can tell you, I'd rather be somewhere else. Our police department is having its annual award celebration. I was intending to have practice with my son, who has his first T-ball game this Saturday, but no, I'm here, because this issue is vitally important to not just our city, but to the community as a whole.
So I think that's why you don't see a lot of the people. You know, you don't see some of the CRAs here. We certainly believe that the April 13th workshop was a day that was, and I will be honest with you with my own opinion. I mean, I've presented in 05, 08, 09, 10, 12. I mean, I don't know how many times I've been before the commission and presented on CRAs. I'm going to be honest. I highly doubt that a four-hour workshop is going to get the meaningful discourse that this commission would like and a reasonable outcome. I mean, I just don't believe that that's the case. So, I mean, I hope that the commission is prepared, and I think, I mean, and I'm not in opposition to, again, I think you have the authority to do your current resolutions. I mean, I respect the fact, Commissioner DeBio, you acknowledge some of the concerns that I raised at the last one. They were removed from that in terms of the rescinding and the rescinding and revoking all the powers delegated to the CRAs. So I'm very appreciative of that, that it's a commission that's willing to be, you know, open and listen. I understand your frustration, but what I can tell you, and you know, and I don't get paid by the City of Melbourne. That's obvious, but you know, going to the market, you know, if that's what their intent is, and I don't know the structure of their deal, but I can tell you, going to the market, you know, just on advanced refunding, it took us 6 weeks, working with the underwriters, the underwriter council, the bond council, going back and forth and looking at all that, then going out to the market, and then, you know, and then getting to closing. I mean, it doesn't happen in a matter of a 2 week period. Even doing a simple bank qualified note doesn't happen. I mean, if they don't have a rating. And I'll tell you, most CRAs, you know, I apologize, and I know it may be very hard, but there are some CRAs that actually take their CRA plan, and if they can demonstrate to a rating agency, based on the increment, the tax increment revenues are going to be, they will bond it out to the end of the year for the purposes of facilitating and making all the projects that they contemplate. Participation in a public-private partnership is expressly allowed in the statutes. I can tell you, our former City Hall site, we've been struggling to, and, you know, and we're starting to get some interest again, but we finally had to, you know, just we decided to pull out of the deal because of the developer at the time needed more, they wanted more time. But there was an inducement, you know, where the CRA was going to provide the land to the developer and then pay for some of the off-site impacts. It's the only way that, I mean, especially for the City of Cocoa. I mean, I understand what we're saying about this money's coming from the county, but I know I can tell you, and I've provided, I believe I've provided all the information that you've asked for, and I think I provided it in a very detailed manner and even went above and beyond. I provided it to every member, but I know since 1993 when we've had our centralized software, the City of Cocoa residents and property owners have contributed $52.8 million to the County General Fund. In return, over that same period of time, they've received $9.5 million, or 18% back, in support of the CRAs. It's, you know, and you sit there and you have to, you really do, you know, because the citizen's like, well, what do I get from the county? And I get it, you know, we're looking, you know, it's like there are services that are being provided to Cocoa residents, but a lot of the services, you know, well, Parks and Rec, no, because there's a District 4 rec fee. Okay, I mean, okay, corrections, clearly everybody pays for that. The Department of Health, I don't know all the funding sources that you have for Department of Health, but we've gone through and we've looked at it because I think that's a meaningful part of the discussion, is that it's a partnership between the cities and the county to address areas in blight. I'm not going to speak about the efficacy and propriety of every CRA that exists in this county. I can speak with certainty about Cocoa CRAs. Yes, Historic Cocoa Village is doing well. But I can take you through Cocoa Village or the Cocoa CRA downtown and show you high vacancy rates. I can show you low-income areas. I can show you areas we have problems. We've got Brevard Avenue, the former City Hall site. It's been vacant now since 2009 and demolished. And we're having difficulty attracting somebody to come there. I mean, and we've had several developers I've gone out. So, I mean, that's why they do provide an inducement or an enticement to bring somebody there, because the idea is they're trying to grow their tax base. I get the increment. So if they get a project, project's going to, over time, if you know, you typically do a return on investment, how long is it going to take? You know, if we're foregoing this amount of revenue, of TIF revenue, well, within 10 years, we're going to be, it's going to take us 10 years to get that back. But now, at the end of the day, when the CRA goes away, and they will go away, you know, I mean, if it's not as under the current, you know, statutory arrangement, if you don't, House Bill 13 was filed yesterday that talks about potentially eliminating them all, and I think it was 2037. So it addresses certain issues, indebtedness, and addresses the potential elimination of them. But it is a little frustrating because, you know, we do, and that's one of the reasons why that former resolution I thought was important is because, you know, we have to drop everything to come here. Because if we're not here, you don't think it must not be important to them because they're not there. Well, it is important, but when you find out, like, you know, you see it's posted in asterisk 10:13 a.m., I mean, it's very difficult. I mean, I had to cancel meetings this afternoon and review the resolution, make some other things, prepare some comments. But, well, the one thing I do want to address, a couple things, but it says in your own resolution in the recitals, I've highlighted it, and this goes back to, and I don't disagree. I mean, if you want to put that moratorium on the debt, it would apply to post-charter CRAs. The reality is Cocoa, Titusville, Melbourne, and I think maybe one of the Myra ones, which you don't have control over indirectly, are the ones that existed prior to the charter. And, you know, for Cocoa CRA, I think, you know, unless, you know, we tried to be responsible. In 2008, we did a waterfront master plan. We didn't amend the CRA plan. We could have amended the CRA plan and got 30 more years, which, because you can max a 60. We didn't do that because we said it was consistent with the existing plan. You know, and it does say that we should be updating and looking at it, and that's what, and we are. You know, we've got a piece of property. You talk about that, what's happening. The city purchased, because the CRA doesn't have the money, the city purchased a mobile home park. Do you know how difficult it is to get rid of a mobile home park? They are cash cows. But look at the clientele. You know, and not all mobile home parks, but let's face it, an overwhelming majority, they're a cash cow, number one, but it's high rate of calls for service for public safety, for code enforcement. I mean, it's significant. So the city purchases it, enters an MOU, and says, listen, with the CRA, that we're going to master plan it, and then we're going to give it to you, and then we're going to expect you to, you know, you're going to have to pay what the appraised value is for the property. You know, so we have that out there, and we haven't done anything because the city did all the environmental site assessment, did all the surveying, did all those things in advance to prepare the property so it would be conducive for development. So when we turned it over to the CRA, because the laws governing the CRA as it relates to the disposition of property are more favorable with the CRA doing it than with the county or the city doing it. So I just, with regard to if the concern is, this already admits or acknowledges it doesn't affect those CRAs. The last thing, a couple things, the current statutes provide if there's a modification of Community Redevelopment Plan 163-361, that prior to that modification, we have to, the agency shall report such proposed modifications to each tax authority in writing or by an oral presentation or both. And then if you go back to Section 163-346, I think it provides for a 15-day notice. So you're going to get noticed, you know, and you also have the power, you know, because it's specifically for those charter ones. So if you want to impose the debt thing, I get it. I mean, we have one CRA. They've been doing pay-as-you-go. So now they're under the former resolutions about getting rid of CRAs that don't have debt. They're going to be punished. They're going to be punished because they're doing pay-as-you-go. And there is no CRA in this. It used to be called the Census Tract 626 CRA. And that was because it was one of the poorest census tracts in the state of Florida, the most underserved and disadvantaged area. Commissioner Smith, you've been there. Commissioner Barfield, I know you've been there. I invite all of you to come there. And the level of poverty, unemployment, crime, single-family female-headed households, lack of educational attainment. And we're starting to see stuff happening there. And it's not just this. I mean, the city's building a regional stormwater facility for the Diamond Square redevelopment area. So those are numbers that you're not seeing on your sheets on how much money you're putting out. I mean, for that for CRA, I think the county's putting out $35,000 a year. But because, and they have, I mean, and they've done some, they're working on some, the Stone Street. You know, there's a lot of things, but I guess the other thing is be mindful that 62.6% of our population in the county reside in incorporated areas. And when we consider that, I mean, that's where most of the activity happens. And if you don't reinvest in these areas, I mean, you'll hear folks from the EDC, you drive by, I've had former commissioners, you've got to do something along 520, John.
You know, people drive there on their way to the beaches, and it just looks horrendous. Well, we've invested in 520. We did a streetscape project. You know, we didn't do the grandiose thing. It was very minimalistic. We actually recycled trees from the U.S. 1 widening. We now have, it was reported today, we've known about it for a while, but a Wawa going there. We had Family Dollar developed there. O'Reilly's. We're starting to see stuff happening. And then the Family Dollar, there was, it backed up against the Provost Park where kids play soccer. And there was 13 contaminants on that site. So the CRA worked with that developer, and they got the site cleaned up. That's what a redevelopment agency does. It tries to induce and attract redevelopment. Now, I get it. As a city manager, it's an expense item for me, too, in terms of, you know, what could I do with that, you know, I mean, X number of dollars that goes into the general fund that I have to expense out. So anyway, the last thing I'll tell you is we are meeting tomorrow, the Space Coast Public Managers, and I think, you know, one of the hope and of the meeting is to, for our meeting tomorrow, is to have a coordinated approach to address the commission, to eliminate and reduce the repetitive presentations and comments, and allow for meaningful discourse, discussion, ideas about the issues on hand. I get it. I mean, and I will be the first one, and I will be going to Tallahassee because, you know, as a city of Cocoa, having CRAs that meet not just one or two components of the statute, we can list all of the ones that we really meet, and we're going to suffer because of bad faith actors. And I'm not saying here, everybody can, a lot of people, the Citizens Oversight Committee used the Miami-Dade grand jury report, the good, the bad, the questionable. I mean, and it just like it paints them all with a broad brush. And I heard it say, let's not say all of them are bad, you know. And just because they've been around a while doesn't mean aren't meritorious or valid of being around. Because if you don't reinvest in these areas, I mean, our community is only as strong as you know as our weakest link. So if we don't reinvest in these areas, it's going to cost us more in the long run. Okay, I know. I went on way long. I still have four minutes and 59 seconds,
sir. I dropped the
ball,
sorry.
That's okay. I still have 4 minutes and 59 seconds.
Run the clock. But you were entertaining.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope I was informative, not entertaining. And I look forward to working with you. I think there's some meaningful, you know, I mean, I've looked at the OPAGA presentation that was just done to the House, local, federal, and I forget the subcommittee, as well as the Auditor General's, and I think there's some meaningful opportunities to come together.
I agree.
It's going to happen. So, thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Zanardi.
I was taking notes, but then I got lost in the conversation after a while. That's okay. I appreciate what you had to say. And again, I mean, obviously, there are good public-private partnerships in every sense, but, you know, you got to question the public-private partnership where they're demolishing a building in a blighted area as opposed to an apartment complex in a downtown city. And I served on a city council for 2 terms, so I am empathetic to what cities do, and I served somewhere where we had a CRA that did nothing for almost 20 years except a couple of sidewalks, some expensive streetlights, and cleaned up a park that they still used to have to patrol quite often. So it was very frustrating for me as a council member to have a board that couldn't agree on good, solid investment in a blighted area. I know they're doing good things now, but I'm not there to cheer them on and say, way to go. I can just do it from the sideline. So, but again, CRAs are to help communities that are suffering. I mean, that's what they were designed to do, but they haven't always done that. And again, it's not painting anybody with a broad brush, but it's taking a closer look to saying which areas, where can we make some tweaks, where can we, you know, they had an issue here, and I'm sure Kurt and Jim remember it well, where there was a CRA paying for police services. And I'm not going to, or fire, I'm sorry. But I mean, it was bad. It was really ugly. They got drugged through the mud, and it made them look very bad because they know that they're not supposed to pay for that out of that funding. I know. So, I mean, again, I don't blame one for all of them, but, however, I think that we need to address it. And it is, if you know, and I always said this back when, you know, you look at the amount of monies that shift from the county to these cities. If these areas are in need of funding and these areas are in need, it's easy to divert those funds to those areas because you have a compelling cause. I know if I have an area that's run down in my city, I'm going to say, let's focus our energies in this area. I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist or a growth management director to figure out that that's where you need to invest your funding. So it's not always the onus isn't always on the CRA to fix the world's problems of the bad part of your city. So, again, I'm looking forward to the workshop. And again, my item next meeting, I think we probably should have done this early on, is probably just, and all it does is it says, okay, we're going to hold here for a minute. And it's not because I don't trust you. You sound very trustworthy, very passionate about your CRA. However, I don't trust them all, and that's the truth. And it's unfortunate, just like people don't trust us. I mean, we do our best to try to always do the right thing, but unfortunately, there are those that won't always do the right thing. So I think that protects us as a county, because we can't assume that everybody's going to always be on the same page, and everybody's not going to fight for their life, for their CRA, or to try to, you know, shovel as much money as they can. So I just pray that the commission next meeting at least looks at this and talks to the county attorney about it and say, what does this mean? Because it's just a hold. And I'm sorry you're forced to come out here and have to explain your CRA every year or two, but I would hope if it's that important to you that that's not always a bad thing either, because then people will listen.
Or every 6 months. Well, I would encourage my fellow commissioners to visit some CRAs if you've never seen one, because they do some good work. And John, yours is one that you can be very, very proud of. But I think you made a very interesting comment. You can't use a broad brush and say all mobile home parks are bad. I would say the same thing about CRAs. The problem, I think that, and I can only speak for myself, but the problem that I have is, and I've said it over and over again for the last 2 years that I've been up here, or two and a half, that we just don't have enough ammunition or enough arrows in our quiver that we have some control, because we hear people complain to us, well, you're wasting $6,000 buying palm trees. Well, we didn't waste the $6,000. We, the commission, didn't have a decision in that. The decision was made by a CRA. So I think those are the kinds of things that we need to talk about in the workshop, and hopefully we can come up with some parameters that will let CRAs go forward and do the good work you do. And when you have a CRA, like Commissioner Rosnardi is speaking about, that isn't doing much, the commission has some power to say, okay, we can shut you down. Tell us why we shouldn't. But right now, we as a commission, we have that. We do not have that power. So speaking again only for myself, it's somewhat frustrating because we don't have the control. So hopefully we can do that at the workshop. But one of my fears, I can tell you, is that if we have commissioners that will not visit a CRA and see what a CRA can do, and maybe visit a CRA that is disturbing and isn't doing much, we're going to wind up spending a lot of time talking past each other, because we're going to point fingers at the ones that we don't like, and the ones that are doing a good job are going to point your fingers back at us and say, look, we're doing a great job. And so we're just going to talk past each other, and we're going to be doing the same thing we've done for the last 12 or 15 years with CRAs, like you mentioned. How many times have you been here? And the CRA people, you know, they get very worried and very concerned that, oh, here we go again. So hopefully this workshop, we can all work together and we can put all of this behind us and we can move forward with some real direction that will give you guys some ground rules and us as well. That's my hope. So anything else? Commissioner Pritchett.
I like that, too. I think what we're going to see, I've only had good experiences with CRAs. Where we come from, I think we're almost the poster child. Yeah. We took areas that had blight. We had prostitution. We had drugs. I mean, it was, nobody was going to do any business down there. It's completely turned it around. There's businesses moving in. The BRICS project moved in down there. We're starting to see a lot of activity. And actually, that CRA is one of the ones that don't have a time limit. When I was on council, we were working hard to get the debt paid off so we could move it out of the CRA zone, so we could start moving other city funds into other areas of the city too. So I don't even know that it's necessarily the heart of every city to keep them going when they don't need to. I think we do need to work towards time periods on them. I think if you can't get it done in 30 years, you probably need to pick another project. So I think there's some things we need to work on. I'm hoping that these CRAs come and present and that we can see the benefits that they're doing. I'm hoping they're all doing some benefits. You know, as far as when we talk about with the fire, I know it was terrible, but, you know, the boundaries worked, and they're paying it all back to the county, which is a good thing. So I'm really looking forward to this, to seeing them coming out and bring their projects, see what good they've done, seeing what we wouldn't have in our areas if we didn't have it. I actually think if these work, it's home rule at its best. So I'm looking forward to the presentations to see what the rest of the county's doing with their CRAs.
Moving right along, we have no public comment cards. Board reports. Mr. Witten.
Mr. Chairman, I sent to you and members of the board an email last night, and it talked a little bit about the process, and this is going to be somewhat CRAs, but I haven't had an opportunity to actually talk with the individual commissioners with regards to their CRA items, because I'm just simply not asked for that. And I can tell you that on each of the resolutions, each time one of the whereases is not quite right. And so I'm experiencing that a little bit. But it was a frustration on the part of staff that, again, you have a resolution that says that if you're going to implement an ordinance, amend or repeal something that affects the cities, that there's a process in place. And I know we've talked about the force of resolutions and policies, and I would say for you all, they may not mean a whole lot, but if you look in the Code of Ordinances and the first directive with regards to the duties and responsibilities of the county manager is to administer and carry out the directives and policies of the Board of County Commissioners and enforce all orders, resolutions, ordinances, and regulations of the board to assure that they are faithfully executed. And so in the ordinance, you give the county manager the directive to make sure that your policies are being followed. And so, again, as you've promised the cities that you would talk on April 13th, you know, it puts and the requests are obviously coming to Sally, but if you draw back to 3.4 of the charter, you know that the county manager is charged with the performance of operations of county government, and so you know, it's becoming confusing for staff because you've tabled at least one of the resolutions, and then we see it again, and so we feel like we're put in a position where we're not doing our jobs in terms of honoring an existing resolution that is enforceable by ordinance through the directives to the county manager. And so that's why I sent out the resolution for the board members and the public. We do the agenda, and we send it up to the clerk's office on Friday afternoon. And so the moment that it leaves our hands and it's in transit, everything that comes in after that is an add-on to the agenda. And so Sally is just the sort of cog in the wheel, but certainly is not playing games with the placement of any items on the agenda. And so just wanted to remind the board that you have this resolution in place that says that we're going to treat the cities as partners, and when you have something that is going to be effective in their corporate limits, that you will give them ample time for input. We have not talked about the format and form of the workshop, and you may want to take some time on Tuesday to talk about that, because again, that sort of seems to be left to either myself coming up with a form and format or working exclusively with the chair to determine what that is. And so I would say that's very critical for a productive session, that you all determine how you want that workshop to proceed. But again, you know, the frustration and the confusion on the part of staff is that we've seen almost literally an item on CRAs come once an agenda, and so that's very difficult for staff to manage. And that's all I have, sir.
Thank you, sir.
No report.
No report. Mr. Barfield?
No report.
Mr. Tobiah?
No report.
Mrs. Nardi?
I guess all I would say to this resolution is that, you know, if this was a concern, because this resolution could probably be applied to many of the things that have come before us, this probably should have been given to us maybe a month ago when these CRA items started coming forward. With that being said, I did get out my agenda item. I sent it over the weekend, and I sent an email to Sally letting her know it would be over the weekend. And it did make it out the same day that the agenda came out, because this item was actually ready prior to, I mean, I probably could have snuck it on the last agenda, but I didn't want to do that because I didn't want it to be a walk-on. I didn't want to get hammered by my fellow commissioners saying, why did you walk this on at the last minute? So I purposely waited. And my computer system, our office moved, so our computer system was down Friday. We were down Monday for part of the day, so that was why it didn't get sent out on time, although the commission should have received it the same day. It actually came out by email before the advanced agenda did, so that would have, it would have been an addition you got before you even saw your agenda. So I just wanted to make that statement. And also, too, on another note, I just wanted to thank Tim and Facilities and the IT department. Everybody's been so wonderful helping us get moved and patient, and everybody's been so lovely. I can't say enough about the staff being so helpful with getting us in the new office. I know logistics can be a little bit hairy, but we are up and running. We're still trying to manage our phone systems a little odd, but we'll get there. Everybody's been willing to help, and I just appreciate the help. That's it.
Ms. Pritchett.
I have no comment.
I have no report. This meeting is adjourned.
The opinions expressed by any member of the public during any period of public comment do not necessarily reflect the views or opinions of the Board of County Commissioners of Brevard County, Florida, Space Coast Government Television, or the program sponsor, and are solely those of the presenter. The Board of County Commissioners of Brevard County, Florida, Space Coast Government Television, and the program sponsor hereby expressly disclaim any and all responsibility or liability for any defamatory or slanderous statements expressed by any member of the public during any such period.